And we are recording already. yeah,
you're not
so
starting with your angle or something.
No, I'm not. I mean, I think I'm fine with this.
Okay.
Because this is a podcast, it has a whole different format and everything.
Okay.
So, you know, different episodes have different formats and everything, right?
Sure.
Supplements, for example, supplementary videos, for example, they just start off. Podcasts have an introduction, they have an opening screen, and then they have us talking, and then we get to the we get to the meat of it, right? And today specifically I wanted to just talk about why we do this entire podcast. You know, actually I think when we first discussed about this, I think this was last October or last August, we said we'll do a podcast, and it was always intended to be a podcast. But at the time, I never thought that we would have a lot to discuss about as such. That is why we sort of went into programming. And I think that was our niche, right? I mean, we're doing these kind of visual things. And
absolutely.
I was very comfortable with that, showing what we could do. It was a great way to learn mathematics or even not just mathematics, or even sort of confront things that I wasn't entirely too comfortable with. You know, growing up, I don't think maths was one of my most favorite subjects.
Oh, okay.
Right. I feel there are a lot of people on the same boat as I am. Right. But visualizing them and seeing them on screen, seeing what they can do for you, it's like
absolutely
a great way to learn it. I mean, a great way to actually get used to mathematics. And I mean, if you're somebody who's in college, or who's just started to learn programming, I think this will be an interesting way to sort of you know, solidify a lot of knowledge or mathematical knowledge that you have. I think that was the end. I think that's where we pivoted into this thing. But I feel that this was always intended to be a podcast where we could have sort of different guests also bringing their own experiences into the podcast space. I think, but yeah, maybe further down the line. But today I just wanted to sort of have our first episode of podcast where we just talk. There is no coding today. You know, I mean, there is something that we have lined up for next week, and I think it'll be very interesting. We'll just go back to our first episode. I think it was called Conway's Game of Life. And the next episode, or the next week's episode, we'll call it the Game of Life 2, where we have an entirely different set of equations, or entirely different set of rules playing out against each other. I think that's for next week. But this week there is no coding, we just talk. And in general, I wanted to sort of address one of the many comments that I've been getting on this channel. It is, why do you do this? Why do you you know, there are a lot of things that we do on our podcast that I don't think there are any real life users, or at least there are no real life users
immediate
real life uses.
Right.
I mean,
For example, many people will do React.
That'll
be something that is directly applicable to, say, a job, or somebody wants to learn something. Whereas what we do has no such immediate benefits.
So there is no such immediate reward as such. I mean, this will not help you pass your certification exam or anything like that.
Right.
It's just pure mathematics and programming and visualization.
So now you want to tell the viewers why.
Why we do it.
Okay.
Right. The why.
Go ahead.
I mean, I think that's the title of this podcast. The why. So I'll just show you what we have. I mean, if you look at all of our episodes. I'm really hoping I'm showing the right screen. Yes, I am. Okay. So if you look at all of our episodes, I think more than half of them, they have like no real world use. I mean, no immediate real world use.
Right.
Like the Britson's algorithm.
Yeah.
Or even the Mandelbrot set.
Sure. Or digital rain.
Or the digital rain.
Which is just fun.
It was just fun to implement, fun
to
do.
Or even the pi episode.
Everybody knows what pi is. I mean, if you wanted pi to a million digits, it's readily available on the internet. There's no need for you to calculate it.
Absolutely.
As such.
But
why do it? Right? I mean,
I
would say this has the same benefit as exercise. I mean, why do you exercise at all? I think the intention is you want to live longer. You want to have a more fruitful life. You want to generally have a healthy life.
Right.
Medical expenses, keep those medical expenses as far away as possible, right, from where you are. I think doing things like these has the same benefit as exercise.
Okay.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
In doing a lot of these visual things, doing graphically raster graphics or vector graphics and all of those things, you are forced to sort of confront some of the inefficiencies of programming. Right? I think I still remember this was when I was using 386 computers. And I think one of the tasks was we had to have a ball move on the screen randomly or something like that. And it wasn't giving us the effect that we were sort of expecting. So, you know, on that day, I learned a lot about loop unrolling and things like that. So loop unrolling is like a very nifty thing where you have, you know, instead of the computer looping something for yourself, you just repeat the same code over and over again inside a loop. And that sort of gave us the effect that we wanted. I forget the exact thing that we were working on, but I still remember the lesson that came out of it, the concept of loop unrolling.
Yeah.
The whole loop unrolling thing is like completely obsolete right now because of how powerful computers are. They're way more powerful than 15 years ago. In 15, 20 years. But that lesson still remained with me. And that's, I think, the whole goal of doing these kind of programmings, these kind of visual, you know, artifacts. And take even the pendulum, for example. It's such a beautiful thing that you can do with just simple math. And I think that's a segue into the next advantage of doing things like this. Right, into learning new concepts, learning new, or at least in my case, confronting mathematics that I was always scared about. Right, like these, I am pretty sure that we have all learned about gravity and the pendulum equation and all of those things in school or college, or one way or the other, you would have learned it. But seeing it happen, what do you say? I mean, I think there is a very famous saying that Newton said, right? That I stand on the shoulders of giants. These giants who had written these beautiful equations that showed that real world phenomenon can be actually written down on paper. When you actually implement them on a computer, you would see that it's so true. I mean, it's so real.
Right.
These things behave in exactly the way that the equations predict.
Predict. Very true.
Right.
They
look so real and everything. And I think in that brings its own satisfaction.
Right.
Completing this, taking something very abstract like an equation, putting it onto a code, and then having it execute is its own satisfaction.
And visualizing it. One advantage that we always show something on
the
canvas.
Show something on the canvas that can be immediately, that you can immediately see and
visualize.
I
think that's something that even non-hardcore programmers
can
look at the results part and enjoy what has.
That's correct.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, man.
And also some things like, for me, say the chaos equation. I hadn't known about it at all. So it's
we
are just doing only visualizing stuff, but we are also learning new stuff. And I'm assuming some viewers are also learning along with us.
Yeah.
So
speaking of viewers, we hit 150 subscribers, which is great. Yeah,
thanks.
Completely organic growth. I mean, I think right from the first 25 subscribers that are just our friends or relatives.
Yes.
But after that, it's been sort of an organic growth.
Right.
And compared to all of the bigger channels, this is nothing.
Right.
But holy hell, think of a classroom with 150
people.
150 people. That's great, right? That's how I sort of it as. It's been a lot of fun. I mean, this has brought in a lot of structure into my weekends. I mean, if not,
which
anything.
Is one of your goals also.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Saturdays to be useful.
Useful.
So one more thing I just struck me is these ideas can be like trampolines for newer ideas.
For newer ideas,
so,
correct.
So if somebody wants to know more about fractals, then they can look up more. We have the code on GitHub.
GitHub.
They can use that and start doing more on that.
More
right?
on that.
So yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, so I think, so if you look at these problems that we've been solving or these things that we've been doing, they don't have any immediate practical use.
Sure.
But they are the same as exercising.
Mm.
And, you know, exercising has its own benefits. Lessons that you will take from here, you will apply to in your professional life.
Yep.
That brings me to an important point. Do you know Formula One? What is the use of Formula One?
Right.
Those
right.
cars are absolutely no use on the road.
And they make they a lot have, of noise.
Yeah, they make a lot of noise. You cannot drive them on, let's say, the streets of Mylapore.
Correct.
So why race them
why
at all?
Why race them at all? Absolutely. Yeah.
Learnings that you get from Formula One are absolutely translated into things that you...
They actually have on...
That have on real Ferrari. Cars.
Yeah, the cars I think Ferraris the most, make and...
Yeah,
especially the no, top just, end
not just Ferraris.
But
have you heard of this KERS recovery system? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's called kinetic energy recovery system or mm-hmm. something like that. I've seen that happen in a Lexus.
Mm.
And so when you brake on a Lexus, that energy is sort of stored somewhere.
Mm.
I wasn't sure if they were storing it in a battery or if they were storing it on.
Mm.
On springs or very sophisticated springs or whatever.
Mm.
But when you were taking a corner, that energy would sort of be given back to you.
Mm.
And instead of slowing down on a corner, you would actually keep the same speed or it would give you like more control or whatever. That was a direct learning from Formula One.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing is absolute fuel efficiencies.
Mm.
Formula One cars typically go, I think, 500, 600 miles.
Mm.
And you cannot be stopping every time your fuel is over.
Right.
So they are under absolute pressure to keep their car's efficiency as high as possible.
True.
So that they can, you know, sort of have as minimal. Little pit stops as possible.
Correct.
So that's another learning.
Yeah.
Tire technology.
Yeah.
Right. 500, 600 miles of the most stressful, most heated roads.
Absolutely.
You had to make sure that the rubber consistency is greatest and
sure.
you know, your tires are the greatest. Mm-hmm. And that translates to what? A couple of years more added to your tire, this thing in a real car.
Right.
So doing things like this.
Which is that MRF famous, right? The tires we race.
Yes.
Are the tires
are
you buy.
Are the tires you buy.
Right.
Yes, that's
right.
correct.
Yeah.
Learnings they take from there, they absolutely put
yes.
it over.
So coming back to our thing, you're saying that there are learnings from just doing this.
Just
that
doing
could
this.
Be
just
useful.
Core programming. You know, not doing anything professionally, just doing this.
Solving
problem. It will expand your mind into solving other problems.
Absolutely. I do agree with that. Yeah.
I think that's one of the biggest things that I see out of this.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, man. I mean, I think, you know what? If we make this podcast a regular thing, I mean, this is our first podcast in 33 episodes. So this is like the 33rd episode.
Right.
So after 32 videos, we made one. So this is once every 6 months or so.
Right.
So if we do make this regular, I think here's what I was thinking. When you are talking in a podcast, there is definitely a time when the conversation will come to a lull.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing to talk about.
Sure.
And I think we definitely need some kind of Arduino device that tells you that the conversation has come to a lull.
Right.
All you need is like, I think a sound sensor.
Mm.
And if the sound sensor and if the sound goes below a particular threshold for X amount of time, you can say that the conversation is over and the podcast is over.
Sure.
I think you can call it quits right over there.
Absolutely.
I mean, I think what I wanted to save at least for this episode, I think I'm done.
Sure.
But that doesn't mean that the episode itself is over. I just wanted to sort of hopefully I'm on the right screen. I just wanted to show our
website.
Yeah.
If you can get the
I know it. Well, the keyboard is somehow giving us an issue. So first things first, this is our episode where you can actually, I mean, this is our website where you can actually see
the
canvas that we do every week. You can actually see it play out.
Very cool.
So if you don't, I mean, if you have just watched the episode and if you just want to see the canvas play out, this isn't a video. This is the actual canvas that we coded in the episode.
Right.
I think one more thing, if I can showcase, I mean, things like Pi and all, I cannot showcase because Pi, we did it in Java. So there's no applet or anything, but in place of that, I do place images, you know, things like that.
Right.
I do place images Even the case of the ICMP trace route, which was once again a Python episode, I have put up images for different trace routes that we did.
Very cool.
Let's take this 3D to 2D projection.
Yes.
Yeah. So you can see the 3D to 2D projection happening. And then what else? Is there a specific subject that? Oh yeah, Galton board. I mean, this was a long episode. I think this was the Galton board was our longest episode. And I think I'll just leave this. I wanted to sort of just. I don't think we've properly shown our website
which is actually very well done. RK.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Thanks. So there is an Easter egg hidden on the website. So I'll leave it to you to actually find out what the Easter egg is. It's actually pretty easy to find.
Okay.
And I'm not leaving out any clues or anything. Okay. I don't want to leave out any clues or anything. All right.
Nice. Very cool. Yeah.
So let's continue with this section of the podcast. You know, I want to make this a staple section of the podcast going on forward. So what I wanted to actually discuss was the case of a 500-mile email. When we talk about programming or computers or hardware or software, there are some things in the computer world that are sort of some problems in the computer world that sort of stick out. And stay for a very, these are very notable hardware and software problems. I want to start off with something very light, and I'll put a link to this one in the description so that people can read it for themselves, the entire, the whole aspect of the problem.
Right.
But this is called as the case of the 500-mile email. There isn't a programming forum on the internet. Where people have been there long enough and this doesn't get mentioned. All right. This sort of actually makes you confront the physics of things. That your hardware and software speed and everything is constrained by the physics of the universe itself. So this is one of those very famous problems. There are actually very... there are other very interesting issues also. I'm pretty sure you've known about the... what's that famous Iran nuclear thing that they had? Oh, come on, you must know this.
No,
the bug that they that I think Israeli and the US intelligence introduced into the.
I've heard about it.
Yeah, shit! I can't for the life of me. Stuxnet. You remember this one? The Stuxnet?
No, I don't remember actually.
So we'll probably leave it for another day. But those are very famous computer problems. There's also a very a sad story with one of these very famous computer problems. And I think it was a programmer who was designing an operating system to basically control radiation treatment hardware. Basically this hardware or this computer would be used to sort of, provide very exact doses to cancer patient. Okay. Exact doses of radiation to cancer patients. And the issue was that he had forgotten to put in, race conditions, or he had forgotten to sort of handle race conditions within the software. And that caused a lot of deaths. I think there were two or three deaths that happened because of that. But today, at least, we'll just talk about this the case of the 500-mile email. So there is this hardware engineer. Basically, he's like the IT administration of a university.
Right.
And they are just upgrading their operating system. Right. And this happened in 2002, I guess. This is happening in 2002. They're upgrading their operating system, I think, from Sun OS 5 to Sun OS 8. And they come across this weird... And after the upgrade happens, they come across this weird issue where nobody beyond a 500-mile email... 500-mile radius is able to receive emails.
Okay.
All right. And how he found out that this is there is a 500-mile limit was that I think it was one of the departments of the university that was affected was geostatisticians, basically statisticians. And these people, when they found out that emails were not going out, instead of just simply reporting it to IT, they took the time to find to send emails to their closer counterparts, to a little bit farther away and a little bit farther away, and until they discovered that anybody outside of that 500-mile email, 500-mile radius was not able to see emails.
Right.
So I think that's where the problem, that's where they discovered, that's what, that's the name in the case of the 500-mile email. And I think, yeah, I mean, and how he found that out, I mean, finally he did find out that it happened because of a timeout issue. So there was a send mail configuration file where I think the configuration was replaced, or the timeout was replaced to zero. So your POP email would just basically send the message, but it would wait exactly 0 seconds for the...
or 3 milli... light seconds, which is
I mean, basically not, I mean, it wouldn't wait for the reply to come back.
Correct.
It would only wait for, like, you know, 0 seconds. So anything that was within that 500 mile limit would I mean, it would see the reply coming back.
Okay.
But any email that goes outside of that limit, it would wait for the server to send a reply back. That server wouldn't reply back, so it timed it out.
Okay.
I think that's what had happened. And yeah, it boils down to, I think, so yeah, so let me just read this last paragraph. An odd feature of our campus network at the time was that it was 100% switched. An outgoing packet wouldn't incur a router delay until hitting the POP and reaching a router on the far side. So time to connect to a lightly loaded remote host on a nearby network would actually largely be governed by the speed of light distance to the speed of light distance to the destination, rather than by incidental router delays. Feeling slightly giddy, I typed into my shell 3 milli light seconds, which translates to 558 miles. That is why this is called as the 500 mile email problem.
Right.
So anything that was within the speed of light limit, they would get a reply back on their from the router. So that email would be successful. Anything beyond that, they just wouldn't get it. It would just mark it as failure, and then it would be, it would be gone. I think yeah, so this is one of those very famous email or computer problems, and I think you know, I mean, I think at least it is worth mentioning, or worth bringing it up.
It would be nice to learn this,
Be nice to learn. I think we have a few more things, you know, lined up. We'll bring it up in those specific podcasts as it is needed.
Right.
All right, man. And so that brings us to the last and final section of this podcast.
Yeah.
The funny.
That's programmer funny.
That's programmer funny, right? So I have some memes and things just picked out so that we can just see them and
enjoy.
Yeah. So this is something I think somebody tweeted or Facebooked, I'm not sure. When someone asks you what programming language they should learn, don't simply answer the one you prefer. First, ask them what area they plan to focus on. For example, web front end, JavaScript, back end, JavaScript. So everything is just JavaScript. Yeah. I mean, I think, sign of the times, I guess. This is a tweet. I appreciate the honesty. Pick a password. Don't reuse your bank password. We didn't spend a lot on security for this. I really wish all everybody was this
honest.
I think this has to be the funniest. Is a before and after alcohol.
Right.
Alcohol, cocaine, heroin, and JavaScript. He looks so happy in this one.
Happy and hairy.
Happy and hairy also. Innocence level infinity. Mom trying to delete all my games. Me watching her delete desktop
icons. Desktop icons. Actually, yeah, this is, I like this one also.
I'm a pull stack developer. Just pull things off the internet and put it into my code. I think this is all of us, man.
Yeah. Very nice. Pull stack.
Yeah. I don't, my code doesn't work. I have no idea why. And it works. My code works. I have no idea why.
Which also happens to a lot of us.
Yeah. Entirely too often. Yeah. This is very topical. I mean, there is a ship called as the Ever Given. It's currently blocking the Suez Canal. And apparently 30% of the world trade.
Yeah.
It's blocking. So, yeah. So, cyber attack. And a woefully
inadequate
cyber security team. Very topical. Yeah, so yes, let me just switch back. There you go. Okay. I think I think that's about it. Thank you so much for joining. And
give us feedback on on the podcast.
Yeah.
How do you like this format? Any topics that you might have for us to discuss?
Yes. We are at 150 subscribers. Thank you so much for that. Do tell your friends.
Yes.
Yes. And next week, we'll get back to our regularly scheduled programming. Yep. That's it.
See you.
See you.